Section 1 of On the Death of Satyrus and On the Belief in the Resurrection. On the Death of Satyrus and On the Belief in the Resurrection by Ambrose of Milan. Translated by H. de Remestin. On the Death of Satyrus. We have brought hither, dearest brethren, my sacrifice, a sacrifice undefiled, a sacrifice well-pleasing to God, my Lord and brother Satyrus. I did not forget that he was mortal, nor did my feelings deceive me, but grace abounded more exceedingly. And so I have nothing to complain of, but have cause for thankfulness to God, for I always desired that if any troubles should await either the church or myself, they should rather fall on me and on my house. Thanks therefore be to God that in this time of common fear, where everything is dreaded from the barbarian movements, I ended the trouble of all by my personal grief, and that I dreaded for all which was turned upon me. And may this be fully accomplished, so that my grief may be a ransom for the grief of all. Nothing among things of earth, dearest brethren, was more precious to me, nothing more worthy of love, nothing more dear than such a brother, but public matters come before private. And should any one inquire what was his feeling, he would rather be slain for others than live for himself, because Christ died according to the flesh for all, that we might learn not to live for ourselves alone. To this must be added that I cannot be ungrateful to God, for I must rather rejoice that I had such a brother than grieve that I had lost a brother, for the former is a gift, the latter a debt to be paid. And so, as long as I might, I enjoyed the loan entrusted to me. Now he who deposited the pledge has taken it back. There is no difference between denying that a pledge has been deposited and grieving at its being returned. In each there is untrustworthiness, and in each eternal life is risked. It is a fault if you refuse payment, and piety if you refuse a sacrifice. Since, too, the lender of money can be made a fool of, but the author of nature, the lender of all that we need, cannot be cheated. And so, the larger the amount of the loan, so much the more gratitude is due for the use of the capital. Wherefore I cannot be ungrateful concerning my brother, for he has given back that which was common to nature, and has gained what is peculiar to grace alone. For who would refuse the common lot? Who would grieve that a pledge specially entrusted to him is taken away, since the Father gave up his only Son to death for us? Who would think that he ought to be excepted from the lot of dying, who has not been accepted from the lot of being born? It is a great mystery of divine love that not even in Christ was exception made of the death of the body, and although he was the Lord of nature, he refused not the law of the flesh, which he had taken upon him. It is necessary for me to die, for him it was not necessary. Could not he who said of his servant, "If I will that he tarry thus until I come, what is that to thee?" not have remained as he was, if so he willed? But by continuance of my brother's life here, he would have destroyed his reward and my sacrifice. What is the greater consolation to us than that according to the flesh Christ also died? And why should I weep too violently for my brother, knowing as I do that divine love could not die? Why should I alone weep more than others for him, for whom you all weep? I have merged my personal grief in the grief of all, especially because my tears are of no use, whereas yours strengthen faith and bring consolation. You who are rich weep, and by weeping prove that riches gathered together are of no avail for safety, since death cannot be put off by a money payment, and the last day carries off alike the rich and the poor. You that are old weep because in him you fear that you see the lot of your own children, and for this reason, since you cannot prolong the life of the body, train your children not to bodily enjoyment but to virtuous duties. And you that are young weep too because the end of life is not the ripeness of old age. The poor too wept, and, which is of much more worth and much more fruitful, washed away his transgressions with their tears. Those are redeeming tears, those are groanings which hide the grief of death, that grief which, through the plenteousness of eternal joy, covers over the feeling of former grief. And so, though the funeral be that of a private person, yet is the mourning public, and therefore cannot the weeping last long which is hallowed by the affection of all. For why should I weep for thee, my most loving brother, who wast thus torn from me, that thou mightest be the brother of all? For I have not lost, but changed my intercourse with thee, Before we were inseparable in the body, now we are undivided in affection, for thou remainest with me, and ever wilt remain. And indeed, whilst thou wast living with me, our country never tore thee from me, nor didst thou thyself ever prefer our country to me, and now thou art become surety for that other country, for I begin to be no stranger there where the better portion of myself already is. I was never wholly engrossed in myself, but the greater part of each of us was in the other. Yet we were each of us in Christ, in whom is the whole sum of all, and the portion of each severally. This grave is more pleasing to me than thy natal soil, in which is the fruit not of nature but of grace. For in that body which now lies lifeless lies the better work of my life, since in this body too which I bear is the richer portion of thyself. And would that, as memory and gratitude are devoted to thee, so too, whatever time I have still to breathe this air, I could breathe it into thy life, and that half of my time might be struck off from me and be added to thine. For it had been just that for those, whose use of hereditary property was always undivided, the period of life should not have been divided, or at least that we, who always without difference shared everything in common during life, should not have a difference in our deaths. But now, brother, whither shall I advance, or whither shall I turn? The ox seeks his fellow and conceives itself incomplete, and by frequent lowing shows its tender longing if perchance that one is wanting with whom it has been wont to draw the plough. And shall I, my brother, not long after thee? Or can I ever forget thee, with whom I always drew the plough of this life? In work I was inferior, but in love more closely bound, not so much fit through my strength as endurable through thy patience, who with the care of anxious affection didst ever protect my side with thine, as a brother in thy love, as a father in thy care, as older in watchfulness, as younger in respect. So in the one degree of relationship thou didst expend on me the duties of many, so that I long after not one only, but many lost in thee, in whom alone flattery was unknown, dutifulness was portrayed. For thou hadst nothing to which to add by pretence, inasmuch as all was comprised in thy dutifulness, so as neither to receive addition nor await a change. But whither am I going, in my immoderate grief, forgetful of my duty, mindful of kindness received? The apostle calls me back, and as it were puts a bit upon my sorrow, saying, as you heard just now, "We would not that ye should be ignorant, brethren, concerning them that sleep, that ye be not sorrowful as the rest which have no hope." Pardon me, dearest brethren, for we are not all able to say, "Be ye imitators of me, as I also am of Christ." For if you seek one to imitate, you have one whom you may imitate. All are not fitted to teach. Would that all were apt to learn. But we have not incurred any grievous sin by our tears. Not weeping proceeds from unbelief or weakness. Natural grief is one thing, distrustful sadness is another, and there is a very great difference between longing for what you have lost and lamenting that you have lost it. Not only grief has tears, joy also has tears of its own. Both piety excites weeping, and prayer waters the couch, and supplication, according to the prophet's saying, washes the bed. Their friends made a great mourning when the patriarchs were buried. Tears, then, are marks of devotion, not producers of grief. I confess, then, that I too wept, but the Lord also wept. He wept for one not related to him, I for my brother. He wept for all in weeping for one, I will weep for thee in all, my brother. He wept for what affected us, not himself, for the Godhead sheds no tears, but he wept in that nature in which he was sad, he wept in that in which he was crucified, in that in which he died, in that in which he was buried, he wept in that which the prophet this day brought to our minds. Mother Zion shall say, "A man, yea, a man was made in her, and the Most High himself established her." He wept in that nature in which he called Zion mother, born in Judea, conceived by the Virgin. But according to his divine nature, he could not have a mother, for he is the creator of his mother. So far as he was made, it was not by divine but by human generation, because he was made man, God was born. But you read in another place, "Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." In the word child is an indication of age, in that of son the fullness of the Godhead. Made of his mother, born of the Father, yet the same person was both born and given. You must not think of two, but of one. For one is the Son of God, both born of the Father and sprung from the Virgin, differing in order, but in name agreeing in one, as to the lesson just heard teaches, for a man was made in her, and the Most High himself established her. A man indeed in the body, the Most High in power. And though he be God and man in diversity of nature, yet is he at the same time one in each nature. One property then is peculiar to his own nature, another he has in common with us, but in both he is one, and in both he is perfect. Therefore it is no subject of wonder that God made him to be both Lord and Christ. He made him Jesus, him that is, who received the name in his bodily nature. He made him, of whom also the patriarch David writes, Mother Zion shall say, A man, yea, a man is made in her. But being made man, he is unlike the Father, not in Godhead, but in his body, not separated from the Father, but differing in office, abiding united in power, but separated in the mystery of the Passion. The treatment of this topic demands more arguments by which to demonstrate the authority of the Father, the special property of the Son, and the unity of the whole Trinity, but today I have undertaken the office of consolation, not of discussing, although it is customary in consoling to draw away the mind from its grief by application to discussion. But I would rather moderate the grief than alter the affection, that the longing may rather be assuaged than lulled to sleep. For I have no wish to turn away too far from my brother, and to be led off by other thoughts, seeing that this discourse has been undertaken, as it were, for the sake of accompanying him, that I might follow in affection him departing, and embrace in mind him whom I see with my eyes. For it gives me pleasure to fix the whole gaze of my eyes on him, to encompass him with kindly endearments, whilst my mind is stupefied, and I feel as though he were not lost, whom I am able still to see present. And I think him not dead, my services to whom I do not as yet perceive to be wanting, services to which I had devoted the whole of my life, and the drawing of every breath. What then can I pay back in return for such kindness and such pains? I had made thee, my brother, my heir. Thou hast left me as the heir. I hoped to leave thee as survivor, and thou hast left me. I, in return for thy kindness, that I might repay thy benefits, gave wishes. Now I have lost my wishes, yet not thy benefits. What shall I, succeeding to my own heir, do? What shall I do, who outlive my own life? What shall I do, no longer sharing this light which yet shines on me? What thanks, what good offices can I repay to thee? Thou hast nothing from me but tears, and perchance, secure of thy reward, thou desirest not those tears which are all that I have left. For even when thou wast yet alive, thou didst forbid me to weep, and didst show that our grief was more pain to thee than thine own death. Tears are bidden to flow no longer, and weeping is repressed, and gratitude to thee forbids them too, lest, whilst we weep for our loss, we seem to despair concerning thy merits. But for myself at least thou lessenest the bitterness of that grief. I have nothing to fear who used to fear for thee. I have nothing which the world can now snatch from me. Although our holy sister still survives, venerable for her blameless life, thy equal in character and not falling short in kindly offices, yet we both used to fear more for thee. We felt that all the sweetness of this life was stored up in thee. To live for thy sake was a delight, to die for thee were no cause of sorrow, for we both used to pray that thou mightest survive. It was no pleasure that we should survive thee. When did not our very soul shudder when a dread of this kind touched us? How were our minds dismayed by the tidings of thy sickness? Alas for our wretched hopes, we thought that he was restored to us whom we see carried off, and we now recognize that thy departure hence was obtained by thy vows to the holy martyr Lawrence. And indeed, I would that thou hadst obtained not only a safe passage hence, but also a longer time of life. Thou couldst have obtained many years of life, since thou wast able to obtain thy departure hence. And I indeed thank thee, almighty everlasting God, that thou hast not denied us at least this last comfort, that thou hast granted us the longed-for return of our much-loved brother from the regions of Sicily and Africa, for he was snatched away so soon after his return as though his death were delayed for this alone, that he might return to his brethren. Now I clearly have my pledge, which no change can any more tear from me. I have the relics which I may embrace, I have the tomb which I may cover with my body. I have the grave on which I may lie, and I shall believe that I am more acceptable to God, because I shall rest upon the bones of that holy body. Would that I had been able in like manner to place my body in the way of thy death. Hadst thou been attacked with the sword, I would have rather offered myself to be pierced for thee, had I been able to recall thy life, as it was passing away. I would have rather offered my own. It profited me nothing to receive thy last breath, nor to have breathed into the mouth of thee dying, for I thought that either I myself should receive thy death, or should transfer my life to thee. Oh, that sad yet sweet pledge of the last kiss! Oh, the misery of that embrace, in which the lifeless body began to stiffen, the last breath vanished. I tightened my arms, indeed, but had already lost him whom I was holding. I drew in thy last breath with my mouth, that I might share thy death, but in some way that breath became life-giving to me, and even in death diffused an odour of greater love. And if I was unable to lengthen thy life by my breath, would that at least the strength of thy last breath might have been transfused into my mind, and that our affection might have inspired me with that purity and innocence of thine. Thou wouldst have left me, dear brother, this inheritance, which would not smite the affections with tears of grief, but commend thine heir by notable grace. What then shall I now do, since all the sweetness, all the solace, in fine all the charms of that life are lost to me? For thou wast alone my solace at home, my charm abroad. Thou, I say, my adviser in counsel, the sharer in my cares, the averter of anxiety, the driver away of sorrow, thou wast the protector of my acts, and the defender of my thoughts. Thou, lastly, the only one on whom rested care of home and of public matters. I call thy holy soul to witness that, in the building of the church, I often feared lest I might displease thee. Lastly, when thou camest back, thou didst chide thy delay. So was thou.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.